Today is February 6th, 2020, and we're in Fondren Library, and I'm Helen.
I'm Antu.
And this is...
Frank Tsuru. Yes.
Okay, so we're going to start with your early life. So where and when were your grandparents born?
My grandparents, I don't have the date, exact date of my grandparents' birth, but it would be somewhere in 1880 or 1890, they immigrated to the United States from Japan in 1910 from my dad's folks, and 1911 from my mom.
And what brought your parents to the States?
Well, my parents were actually born in the United States. Okay. Their parents immigrated here.
Yes, your grandparents.
So my grandparents moved here too, because America was the place to go, and there was a big migration, or immigration, excuse me, of Japanese from Japan mainland to the United States in that time frame, and then at about 1924, the United States stopped any more Japanese and Chinese immigration from coming into the United States.
And then your grandparents settled in Seattle, right? And what brought them to Seattle specifically?
Well, there was a big Japanese community in Seattle. And so America was extremely foreign to them. So what they did is they wanted to get amongst the Japanese community there. So they settled. Both my mom's and my dad's families both settled there.
How did they find that community?
Well, it was before they went. A lot of people went before them, and they said this is where you should go, and so they boarded a ship in Okinawa, which is an island off of Japan, and then went from Okinawa to the port of Seattle.
Did they already know English before they immigrated?
My grandparents did not, and they really spoke Japanese all the time to my parents. It was scary for them, very, very much so.
And how did they handle the language barrier, cultural differences?
My grandfather on my mom's side was more of a laborer, and there were other Japanese that knew more English than helped. My grandfather on my dad's side was a chef, and he started working at a place called the Seattle Tennis Club in Seattle as a kind of a line chef, and he became the head chef there about 10 years later.
Awesome. So I guess living in that Japanese community in Seattle, were they like sheltered from the rest of American culture?
A little bit, I guess you could say that. I'm sorry to say, I don't have a lot of information about that. Their Japanese culture is it still is to this day that Japanese just huddle up with Japanese, and they go back to Japan. And the immigration laws into Japan are very, very difficult. They don't allow, it's very hard to get into Japan to live. And that's why Japanese blood is really pure, and it still is to this day.
And where and when were your parents born?
Both my parents were born in Seattle. And my mom was born in 1928, my dad was born in 1930, or 31. And so they were both born in that community in Seattle.
And then they didn't know each other?
They did not know each other at all. My mom's family was she and two sisters, but one sister got kind of trapped in Japan when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. There was no movement from Japan to the United States. And then my dad's family was a little bit larger. He actually had a brother and a sister trapped in Japan for the duration of the war. And then he had a brother and a sister in the United States with that family.
How big was the Japanese community in Seattle?
It was fairly large. It was probably numbering 20,000 Japanese, something like that.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty big. Mm-hmm. How was it for your grandparents and your parents growing up in America amidst all the sentiments against the Japanese during that time?
Yeah, well, it was difficult, particularly on that fateful day in December of 1941, when the Japanese bombed Pearl mm-hmm. Harbor. It was very much anti-Japanese, mm-hmm. and Chinese would say, "We're Chinese, we're not Japanese," on their storefronts and all that kind of stuff. So the Japanese were very much segregated, singled out, and then in May of 1942, by Executive Order 9066, and you can probably look that up, it was gave the president the authority to incarcerate without trial people, enemies of mm-hmm. United States, mm-hmm. and who would that be? That would be the Japanese mm-hmm. or the enemies. So they, without trial, without anything, made them leave their house, businesses, cars, everything that they, unless they can carry it, behind, and they took them to the camps.
Mm. And how old were they? When
my dad was 12, and my mom was 15. Mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I guess, like, what was the whole process like
yeah.
in the camp?
Well, I have had several stories, discussions with my parents about mm. that, and very scary. I had no idea. My grandparents, as you asked about language, there was a huge language barrier. Could not hear, understand what these soldiers were telling them mm-hmm. to do. They understood they had to come with whatever they could carry. And my mom has said that she had to put on 3 pairs of pants mm-hmm. and shirts and jackets, as many as she could, but it was May and it was warm. Mm-hmm. So they're sweating, but mm-hmm. they had to do that because they needed to carry as much as they could. And so, and a little kid can't carry very much at all anyways. So it was a bit frightening, and you know, it was more than anything, though, it was a it's humiliating mm-hmm. to them that in front of their neighbors and everything, they get by armed guard taken out of their house and had to leave everything behind. They had some time, they had to sell their houses and cars and businesses. Mm-hmm. In a couple days, which is very difficult. Mm-hmm. So, and they loaded them up in train cars and took them to a camp that they didn't even know where. Mm-hmm. They didn't know Idaho. I mean, they didn't have internet to be able to say, "Oh, this is where Minidoka, Idaho is." But they went there, and that's where they had to go.
Mm-hmm. And so, your parents only spoke Japanese too?
Because no, my parents were.
They spoke English.
They spoke. Spoke English fluently just by going. As a matter of fact, they were at American schools.
Okay.
So.
Okay, and then up. So I guess up till middle school, before they enter the camps, they were
yeah.
in school. Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And then, I think you mentioned that they were eventually released.
Yes.
Why were they released?
Well, the government shortly thereafter, within a year or so, realized they really made a mistake mm-hmm. here. These people put in these camps. They have no way of supporting themselves, and particularly they knew that the camps were going to close at some time. And what do they do with all these adults that have no? They haven't worked for 5 years. They've lost all their income that they've were always generating before, and so they found families or companies that would sponsor them, and take care of them and make sure they have a job, a place to live, and education and everything. So there would be different places. And I told you my grandfather was a chef.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a resort in Wisconsin that needed a chef. And so he went, and he didn't know what Wisconsin were. And they were in Seattle, Washington. They had no idea anything east of, you know, the city limits, what it was like. And so they went to Wisconsin and started a life there. And that was about a year and a half after they entered the camp.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, my mom's family, he was a laborer. He really, there was nobody that really needed him.
Mm-hmm.
And so he endured life through 1945 in the camp.
Mm. Okay.
And so they had to stay in the camp. Because
oh.
There was nobody that really said, I need a laborer.
So they were, so only the people who were needed were able to be released, pretty much?
That's probably right. Okay. I don't really know, but, you know, if your resort needs a head chef, mm-hmm. and there's a renowned head chef. As a matter of fact, I told you my grandfather on my dad's side at the Seattle Tennis Club became the head chef there.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, the Seattle Tennis Club said, we will be responsible 100% for this family.
Mm-hmm.
Take care of them, make sure they're not spies or anything. And the government wouldn't let them do that because
mm-hmm.
it's too far, too close to the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
They needed all Japanese inland, so they didn't cause, and I know, weren't spies.
Yeah. And so both your parents were in the same internment camp?
Yeah,
and
no, that's right.
Did they meet in there?
It's interesting. No, my mom and my dad's sister
mm-hmm.
were friends.
Okay.
You know, and, but yes, they both, since they were in the same community, they got put in the same trains and shipped mm-hmm. off to the same camp, and that's where they spent their time, but
mm-hmm.
My mom and dad met later in Chicago.
Oh,
yeah.
What brought them to Chicago?
Well, my mom's family eventually was sponsored by a Catholic church
mm-hmm.
in St. Louis.
Okay.
Okay? And a mutual friend was getting married, and that's when they met, like
mm-hmm.
1956 or 57, somewhere in there. Was when they met, and they got married in January of 1958.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
I guess when they were around the time that they met and they got married, were there still kind of like anti-Japanese sentiments during that time?
Oh yes, very yeah. much so. It wasn't as bad further inland that you got,
mm-hmm.
but it's still. You guys know, if you look different, then
mm-hmm.
you're able to be picked out very easily, very quickly. And there were people that were just great that wanted you to be there in their community, and there's people that didn't. And, you know, you can understand, for instance, someone, their son got killed in the war in Japan or in the Pacific Theater. And they have huge issues with the Japanese,
mm-hmm.
and that's what happens. So you have a lot of that.
Yeah. And going to you, where and when were you born?
So I was born in Chicago,
mm-hmm.
March 2nd, 1960.
Mm-hmm.
So in about 3 weeks, yeah. I'll be 60. So that'll be my birthday. Yeah, big time. So I was born in Chicago, and I had, actually my sister is about 2 years older than me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And she's still in Chicago?
Yes.
And did she stay there her whole life?
Yes. Yeah, she stayed in the Chicago area for her whole life.
Mm-hmm. How would you describe the household you grew up in, or you and your sister?
You know, it's very interesting. My parents wanted us to be extremely Americanized.
Mm-hmm.
They, it was all to do with the camps and World War II and what the government did to them. And I was very young. I recall maybe 9 years old or so. And my talked to my mom and dad. And I said, "Aren't you mad that they took you out of your house and took your house and your car and your business and made you go somewhere that you had no idea, and put you in a prison camp?" Mm-hmm. And it's something that still is interesting. Strikes me as pretty amazing, and I don't know if I'd have the same sentiment, but they said, no, we're not mad, we're actually embarrassed, for number one, for our country of origin to have caused this much harm to our new country that we've adopted, and two, the country we've adopted could not trust us and therefore had to incarcerate us because they're afraid we were going to cause harm to the United States. And so therefore, what one of the things that they were saying is that you kids, my sister and I, will prove the government wrong, and we're going to make you the very best Americans that you can be. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, at least for me, the best thing short of military service to teach a young man how to be a great American is to be a Boy Scout. And so that's my start in my Boy Scouts, is that I had to be understand and learn the characteristics and the qualities of a great American, and that's what Boy Scouts taught me.
Do you recall you as a kid have any reactions about how your parents think about America and Japan? Like, did you feel anything about it?
No, they were focused and very much the thing that they wanted to make sure that I understood was that you can't blend in, okay? Mm-hmm. You don't blend in, but you can exhibit these qualities that of being and learn what Americans perceive as being a great American, and that's what the scouting does. But I always agreed with them, okay? And that's one of the things. Your generation is different. You push back against what your parents really think is best for you. In the 1960s, you didn't. You said yes, ma'am, and yes, sir, and did what they asked you to do without questioning. Questioning was something that was equal to not trusting what your parents are doing for you. So you, without question, went forward and did what they told you to do. So the household was loving, the household was caring, the household was a great place. I loved it. But my mom and dad had the final say. There was no mm-hmm. other way. And, you know, times change, and I'm sure you're brought up maybe a little differently than that. I won't question. You're asking me questions. I won't ask you. But it's just a little different mm-hmm. today.
Did they instill any like Japanese values in the household?
The Japanese values they instilled were very similar to what I needed to learn and understand through scouting, being a great American, and their goals were to make sure that being loving and caring for your fellow man, I think that was one of the big things. They're very strong Catholics. I told you my mom's family was sponsored by a Catholic church, and so they learned, my mom's family learned how important that was. But Japanese values are different than the values in the United States, to the point where there is absolutely, there's a higher authority that is irrefutably the authority on everything. If you recall, in Japan, the emperor of Japan was thought of almost a god. It was a human being, but almost a god. Mm-hmm. And his lineage still goes through to today, the emperor. And at one time, no Japanese people ever saw the emperor. Never saw him in person. Because the emperor wanted to be almost a deity. Wasn't a human. But one of the things in World War II that the Americans required for the peace treaty was that the emperor show himself to the Japanese people, that he's just a human being. And that happened, and ever since then he's been out, and his whole family has been out that way. But it's very critical in the culture that you still have a single authority, that you do what that person does, and you ask for, rather. And even today, there was maybe 50 years ago, I think, 30 years ago, they found Japanese soldiers on these islands because they refused to give up. Mm-hmm. And it's just instilled in them that way. Probably wasn't as much that, but there was a lot of very high ethics, high morals, and high values.
I feel like if I were in your parents' place, my initial reaction would be just hatred towards the government, or American government. Mm-hmm. Did they ever express, like, hatred towards the American government? Because it seems like
no.
They were pretty...
You know, it was absolutely, yeah. As I said, it was absolutely their feeling was their own. It's mm-hmm. their embarrassment. And it's one of the things that Japanese families do, if any shame comes to the family because of an action done, it's very shameful. And they looked at that as that extended family caused shame to them. And so they, by gosh, that was nothing other than their own country, and they were going to prove the government wrong.
And was this like a popular sentiment among the other Japanese families?
No, that's a good question. I would say no.
Okay.
I would say no, because it's not normal,
right.
Like I said, to have that. It'd be, if I was there, I think I'd be more upset. I'd be mm-hmm. mad at what happened.
Right. Yeah. Did you experience any discrimination growing up, personally?
Yes, I did a lot. You know, Vietnam War was going on mm-hmm. at that same time. And there are people that could not distinguish the difference between Japanese and Vietnamese or anything, which I'm sure that's the case. But at the time, yes, and I fought a lot. I mean, kids don't fight today anymore, but I was in a fight in elementary school, junior high school, not as much in high school, but growing up in my early teens and earlier, I would have to, because there was a lot of discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
But I was quickly told by higher authority, being the principal of the school, that I could no longer do that. Mm-hmm. And so I slowed that down. But I was pretty quick to go to fighting. But like I said, it could be just boys growing up. Mm-hmm. And that's a little different than girls growing up.
Yeah.
So,
How has, like, being in the camp influenced how your parents raised you, or do you think?
Oh, it was very much, they raised us to be model citizens, to never, ever have that happen. to the family again.
Mm-hmm. And that I guess encouraged you to join Boy Scouts.
Correct? Yeah.
And when did you join Boy Scouts?
It was when I was 1967.
Mm-hmm. And how old were you?
That was seven years old.
Yeah. How did you like it?
Oh yeah. I mean, I thought it was great, and I learned so much. My son today even says, he goes, "How do you know how to do something? How do you know how to do that?" Well, mm-hmm. I was in Boy Scouts. So.
Yeah. How has being a Boy Scout influence your life values and your outlook on life?
Yeah. Well, it was interesting. So my folks insisted on us not being trying our best, but to be the best. Mm-hmm. That was in everything we did. You're either the best, or you better, you know, have a good reason why not. And so in school and sports and everything, if I didn't come home with the best grades or really be a standout athlete, I had to explain it. And in scouting, I was going to be an Eagle Scout. There was no question about it that I'd go through Cub Scouts and I'd go through Boy Scouts, and ultimately I'll be an Eagle Scout by the time I'm 18 years old. And so that was interesting, because there's a story behind it. My first job that I ever got was as a petroleum engineer for a company that I really wanted to work for. They came to the University of Kansas and interviewed us. And I got, so it was different then. You go, you race up there, and as soon as they post the list, you get your name, you put your name on, mm-hmm. On a list to be considered. And the dean of the engineering school would look at the people on the list and say who gets, because you only got 8 slots that they can interview. And so I was fortunate enough to get on the list. And as far as the, they were only hiring one entry-level petroleum engineer at the time. And I had the interview and I got the job, which shocked me. But and the guys that I was on the list of 8, men that were on there, and it was all petroleum engineering school had all guys and maybe one girl, mm-hmm. So it was like 30 guys and one girl. But so I went to the person that my boss, and he was actually the guy that interviewed us. I said, you know, I know the guys that I interviewed against. I know them all, and we all have about the same GPA, and we have done summer internships at different places. You're like, how did I get the job? Mm-hmm. And he said, well, you guys are all pretty much the same. And basically, you got the job because you were an Eagle Scout. Mm-hmm. And being an Eagle Scout holds a lot of credibility in this organization, and that's why we hired you. Mm-hmm. And so I have this kind of a 3-foot by 4-foot mural that has all my scout patches on it, you know, that my mom gave me, made it for me for my high school graduation. And actually, it's a funny story there too. You know, when I graduated from high school, my buddies were getting shotguns or cars or trips around Europe or whatever, and I get this thing that's a mural of my Boy Scout patches. And I want to tell you, I wasn't mad, but I was a bit jealous that my buddies all got cool things, and I just got this, you know, thing of patches. But as it all turns out, I still have that mm-hmm. mural, and their cars or their guns, they're all gone. But I've taken that mural of patches everywhere, to every office that I've had, all across the oil field, just everywhere. Crappy little trailer offices. I'd hang it on the wall, and I'd be there, and I'd remember that's why. And keep on going, progressively bigger and nicer offices. To today, my office is the on the 56th floor, the tallest building west of Mississippi. I mean, it's just followed me, and it's kind of beat up, and it's kind of old, but it reminds me and keeps me humble mm-hmm. as to how I got my first job.
What was your favorite part about Boy Scouts?
Oh, just learning all sorts of cool things, yeah. so many things, going out on campouts, being with friends that I really enjoyed, just being in the outdoors mm-hmm. and getting to do that. Yeah.
Yeah. What was your Eagle Scout project?
Oh, that's a good question, because quite a few people have asked me that. I'm actually the president of the National Eagle Scout Association for all in the United States, and so I look at all of them. But mine wasn't nearly as elaborate or as good as the ones I get to see today.
Yeah.
But mine, it was at the. We met at the First United Methodist Church in Deerfield, Illinois, what I did, there was this basement area that was really, really dingy, really terrible place, and I got it all cleaned out, painted the walls, put it in some bright lights, and made it a little youth center where we all would go there too, and then there'd be a TV and popcorn maker and all these things that we got to hang out there, but go to a place where you also learn about Christ and maintain your Christian centered values. So that's kind of what it did.
Cool. So going into personal life, how did you meet your wife?
I went to school at University of Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
And that I went in 1978, and I met her in 1980,
mm-hmm.
And so she's we dated there in college, and when I graduated and got my first job, I was drilling oil wells and hunting and fishing and doing guy stuff, you know. And I really didn't think that the relationship would survive something like that. So I broke it off then. And I broke her heart, too. So at least that's what she says. And kind of went my own way and did all that. And you know, like I was saying, went to all these little towns that I worked as in the oil field. And 10 years later, after graduation, there was a 10-year reunion for fraternities and sororities. And we saw each other in a bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't believe it. And it's been that, so I was 1992,
mm-hmm.
1991.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we've been together ever since. Mm-hmm. And it's been great.
How many kids do you have?
Have three kids.
Mm-hmm.
She got married right after we broke up, and she had two kids,
mm-hmm.
and then we have one of our own. The oldest is Seth. Now that they have, this is very interesting. Seth is married to Katie,
mm-hmm.
and they have two kids, Lucy and Stella. Lucy and Stella are Lucy's four, Stella's two. But Seth and Katie, which is his wife, changed their name to last name Tsuru when they were adults. Our middle child, Kylie, who was from the previous marriage, also changed her name mm-hmm. to Tsuru. And, you know, it's a great thing. So Seth's 33, Katie's 33, and the two kids. Kylie's 28, and she just got married last November mm-hmm. to Ben,
mm-hmm.
who's 30, and they live in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And then Bailey's our youngest. She's 24. She'll be 25 here in 2 months. And and she works as a pre-K teacher at Yellowstone Academy downtown Houston, and it's a school for underprivileged kids, and so she's a pre-K 4 teacher. And so that's our family, and Kylie and Ben are in New York City. They got married there, and they're planning in a couple years to come back to Houston, so we'll have the whole family. But anyways, Seth and Katie and Kylie all changed their name to Tsuru, and it was quite a deal because, you know, you can go through your whole life and not really know if you did a good job raising your kids. But when they're adults and they said, "Dad, I'm going to change our name back to Tsuru," it's an amazing thing because that was a validation that they believe that I'm really their father. And it's a phenomenal feeling because many parents don't have that ability. You'll say to your parents, "Yeah, you were great parents. You were great parents," but they have no way of knowing that. And so it was an amazing way for me to have that validation.
So what values did you instill in your children?
It was very important to my wife Stephanie and I to make sure that they knew that first they were very loved, and we always thought that that's probably the most important thing, that they know that they have their love unconditionally by their parents. The other thing, probably as important or more, is to bring them to Christ, to make sure that they are saved and understand the whole concept of salvation. And that was not something that we could do very easily when they were younger. Today it's completely different, and you know, it's been really great to have to know that they've accepted Christ. And then there was a lot of little things that we did as a family that we felt very important. Like we had a lot of rules in the house that were just somewhat lopsided than today, or anybody, and I gave them all the freedom that they wanted. There was nothing that they couldn't do, but if I had reason to believe that they were doing something wrong, that's when I would take away some of those. Instead of giving freedoms or giving abilities to do things, I allowed them to do it, but if there was any reason they were abusing it, then I would bring it back. So that it was, and that's kind of where I think they really understood, well, I've got this freedom, but I also have this responsibility. So I have this responsibility to be, because I really like staying out till midnight. And so therefore I'm going to make sure that I don't have any reason for Mom and Dad to take this away. So
backtracking to your college life. So you mentioned you studied at University of Kansas, correct? And then what year did you graduate?
Graduated in 1982.
1982, okay.
Yes.
And what did you study there?
Petroleum engineering.
Only petroleum engineering?
Yeah.
And did you know you were going to study that going into college?
Yes, as a freshman I entered, I applied for and got into the School of Petroleum Engineering.
And why did you choose petroleum engineering?
Oh man, there's nothing really good reason. I wanted to have something that I'd be out of doors and really get to do things with machinery, and that just fit just so perfect. Yeah. So that's what I
seems like Boy Scouts influence.
Yeah, a lot, too. A lot. You bet. Yeah. Absolutely.
Did you have any struggles in college?
I did. I think it was. You know, I was really used to getting high grades, and after my freshman year, the grades weren't as high, and it was really a tough thing for me to try to tell my folks that my grades weren't what they would expect. And I thought about going to geology. Mm-hmm. And geology was, I don't know if it's easy or not, and I never thought of it, but I really thought about doing that, and it turns out I just said, no, I can get through with this, my petroleum engineering degree, and I really worked through it, and I finished with just above a 3.0 in the engineering school, which is on a curve. It would be closer to the right-hand side of the curve. So I felt good about that after having a pretty rocky start. Mm-hmm. But college was, you know, talk about the freedoms. You had all the freedoms, but there was nobody to take things away mm-hmm. from you, okay? And I was used to, you know, the leash being pulled, mm-hmm. yanked, you know. I didn't have that, so I think my freshman year was a little too much fun, a little less, you know, least amount of studying. So, but I changed that around quickly.
Mm-hmm. Were you satisfied with your college experience?
Oh, I loved
looking
it.
Looking back,
I just loved it. It was fantastic. And University of Kansas has a amazing basketball team. You guys don't already know. You should know. You should follow the Jayhawks because they're the best basketball team in the nation. I think they're ranked number 3 in the nation right now. But I love doing that. I loved everything about it. I had lived in a fraternity. I had a great experience there. It was great. I wish I had today's wisdom and that kind of energy that I had back then. I think I got an email from you at 1 a.m.
Yeah.
I was, see, that's the energy I don't have. I've been asleep for 3 hours by now.
I guess if you could go back and change one thing, what would you change?
I'll tell you, since my wife won't see this, it would be staying with her.
Oh.
Yeah, I should have done that. You know, that I didn't do anything that I have regrets about. Mm-hmm. I really felt extremely satisfied. I felt very blessed to be a petroleum engineer, getting through all that, having doubts about what I was going to do, and taking the right path to graduation. The University of Kansas was a beautiful campus, beautiful place, and I was very fortunate to be there. So I really don't have any regrets, but truly, if I did it over, I wouldn't let the 22-year-old voice in my head say, you gotta go run and be free. I probably would have done something different.
Mm-hmm. And I guess, how did you hear about University of Kansas?
Well, it was interesting. I don't know, I can't remember exactly. They had these big books, these catalogs of different universities, all universities across the United States. And I was leafing through it, and they have ranked stars, academic, social, living standards, blah, athletics, all that kind of stuff. And this one was a state school that I had to pay for it all myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my folks didn't have the money, so I couldn't go to a Rice, let's say. Okay, I mean, and I probably couldn't even get into it today at all. But the universe of schools kind of got smaller because I knew what my tuition. And the tuition, my first year that I went there was $750 per semester.
Wow!
So I could afford that, right? And it was they had stars for value, you know, because that tuition was good. So that's how I looked, and I kind of, University of Illinois, because the Chicago area, a lot of Chicago, my high school went to University of Illinois. Kind of didn't want to do that. I didn't want to be in high school again. University of Iowa, I looked at. Miami of Ohio, I looked at that. And then I looked at Kansas. And I looked at doing a few different things. Actually, petroleum engineering and another field, biomedical engineering. I thought the prosthesis would be cool for handicapped, special needs people. And so that was kind of something I was looking at too.
Did you consider yourself a risk taker in college? I guess saying that you didn't have any regrets in college. Do you think you took risks, or do you just kind of know?
Yeah, I took risks. There's no question. I'm. If you look at a scale of risk taking to super conservative in a kind of for college and in my business career, I would be on more on the right of center on the risk risk, or I'd be left right here. Right would be conservative, and left would be risk taking, and I'd take more. I'm a risk taker.
Mm-hmm. And then going to your career experience. So your first job was a petroleum engineer.
Yes.
And what were your responsibilities in that first job?
Yeah, I was I entered as a production engineer, and which was responsible for maximizing the amount of oil and gas that came out of the ground. I also was a drilling engineer, and some of the areas that I was working, the drilling part of it was not as technical as others. But loved it. I loved that all about it, and I learned so much, and I couldn't get enough of it. I stayed out on the rigs all the time, and I loved every bit of that.
Mm-hmm. Were you able to apply what you learned in college into that job?
Absolutely. It's very different than, say, a marketing or a finance major going into business. I mean, everything that I learned in college, I applied almost immediately into my job.
Mm-hmm.
And my job was just like a master's degree of, 'cause it just took right off from what I learned my senior year on through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and did you have other jobs after that before your previous, or before your current one?
Yes, oh yeah, I did. I was at my first job for 9 years, I think.
Okay.
Then I decided to, I had a short stint that I worked all over the world for a service company that did analytical, electronic analytical work. And I enjoyed that for a little while, but then being gone for 4 months at a time, I didn't like it. So came back. Of course, that's when Stephanie and I got back together then. And then I started a new company, just my own and with two other friends that were with me at my original company. And so we started that, and we purchased a gas field in southwestern Colorado. And those two guys stayed in Denver, and I went to Durango, Colorado, southwestern corner, and started working those wells.
And what inspired you to open your own company?
Oh, it's great. It's really, it's super risky. Mm-hmm. It's super scary, especially when you have a family.
Mm-hmm.
But there's nothing more gratifying when you put something together and say you sell it, and you sell it for this great profit, and it's amazing. I mean, I've sold now seven companies in my career, and it's been, everyone's been very gratifying. and just the number, dollar number isn't as significant as what you started, what you went through, and how you got got it done, and so that was really cool. Mm-hmm.
And so the company you're at now, you also started, right?
Yes.
When did you start that company?
Started that in 2004.
Okay. And then was that started in Houston or?
No, I started it in Durango, Colorado. We were down in Durango, and I started it there. And then in 2007, moved to Houston because the company was getting bigger and bigger. And Houston is kind of where it was, and I was traveling so much, and Houston was where I was headed to all the time. Mm-hmm. So moved the whole family to Houston in 2007.
Mm-hmm. And what are your responsibilities now?
Now, I am the CEO of the pipeline company that I started, and the CEO of the gas and oil production company that my partner actually started, and he asked me to grow it in 3 years ago, 2016. And so I'm kind of got two companies. Yeah. That's why I'm really busy.
I guess what's your biggest takeaway from your entire career experience? Just like being in the workforce.
Well, I have to say that what I've experienced and what has, and it became abundantly clear here recently in the last few months, is that everything we do to the glory of God. And that is, it's an unusual concept for a CEO to talk about that, because most CEOs would say it's because I'm one of the smartest guys around, I've got a great business mind, I've got ability to do this or that, and I know that's not the case. And I know that that if we give the glory to God and we he blesses the company and we are able to do the things that we do and we've accomplished where others can't, others have not. Selling seven companies is absolutely unheard of. One company is mostly the way, if any. Two companies, okay, there's a few. Three, you can count on one hand. And seven is rarefied air. There's just really nobody there. And so I often wonder why, and that's what I come away from with, is the fact that we continue to give the glory to God. We continue to be obedient, and I think obedience is the number one thing.
So going to your identity, how do you identify as? Would you identify as like Asian or Asian American, Japanese American?
I identify as a Japanese American. I just spoke last, I guess it was Wednesday, I spoke at a today's Thursday, Tuesday night. I spoke at a event that Mitsubishi Corporation of America, which is a Japanese company, they're sponsors of the Asia Society here in Houston, and my wife and I are honorary co-chairs of the gala this year. Are you going to that gala?
The Asia Society.
Yeah. No, you guys want to get all dressed up and really fancy? I'll invite you.
I'm down. I love the Asia Society talks.
Yeah, and so we're, and so if you'd like to, I'll contact you. But you have to get all, you know, it's pretty. Do you have any long dresses? Prom dress
that I haven't worn since.
Okay, but so I was able to speak to them, and when people talk to me, they don't expect a Japanese guy to come. And when I talk on the phone, I sound very American. And then not only that, but I'm 6'2". They don't expect that, but it's just enjoyable to connect with them. They're great. It's great to talk with them, and that's how I definitely feel very convicted of my my Jap, not just Asian roots, but Japanese roots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I guess you mentioned how, like, how American you wanted to be. So, why did you identify? Why do you identify as Japanese American as opposed to American?
Well, you know, I didn't want to be as American as I. My parents really were the ones that instilled that in me. They said, no matter what, you're not going to speak Japanese. You're not going to learn any Japanese. You're going to learn English. You're going to be a Boy Scout. You're going to play Little League. You're going to do everything that American boys do.
Mm-hmm.
And because we're going to show that you're an American and you can be trusted.
Mm-hmm. Has your identity as a Japanese American changed throughout growing
yeah,
up?
Yeah, it has. Probably more in the past 10 years than the previous 50.
Mm-hmm. And how has it changed?
That I don't have a feeling there's a stigma against an Asian or a Japanese American.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like actually people look at the Asian society as overachievers.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not something that you should be embarrassed about. You should embrace it. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how I look at it.
And has your family, like your wife and kids, influenced how you identify?
No, they can't. My wife is Caucasian.
Okay.
And so, you know, we have this mixing bowl of a family because my daughter married, his name's Ben Xia, and it's a Chinese last name, but he's from Ghana.
Okay.
And so, I mean, we have the United Nations whenever we go to dinner, but they love the fact that I've embraced and that they've embraced the Japanese culture.
Mm-hmm. And what do you center your life around? It can be like an object or a person, a job.
Nothing from this world.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, again, it's something that, there's a saying, you know, if you worship two gods, you worship none. You can't worship the Lord and worship money. You can't worship the Lord and worship a person. So my love and my centeredness is around my Lord and Jesus Christ and Holy Spirit and but past that, my family is then the most important. My friends, I've got such great friends, really, really great friends here in Houston. And then probably my job.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're 30 and not 60, it's probably number one's your job, right? You just gotta go ahead. Could be your finals that are number one. You know, that it changes.
Yeah.
But my faith is really, really, really strong and really important, and I know having a strong faith is why I've met the success that I've had.
Mm-hmm. If you go back to when you were a child, would you imagine, like, could you imagine yourself how you are now?
Gosh, no.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't. I wish my parents were alive to be able to see what their son has done, because, you know, I'm the president of the National Eagle Scout Association because my mom and dad said you're going to have to be the best Boy Scout that you can be, and that's being the president of the of all Eagle Scouts is something that is hit the pinnacle, and I would just love to have a cup of coffee with my folks and just say, well, I kind of hit it on these three things and I missed it on these two, something like that, whatever.
Yeah. What did you want to be when you were little, I guess?
What did I want to be when I was little? When I was little, I loved sports. Probably wanted to be some kind of athlete. I was probably as big as any of my friends. And so I was able to play high school sports, not good enough for any college sports. And I didn't really have a vocation that I wanted to be. Every boy wants to be best basketball player, or next NBA player, next MLB player, whatever, NFL. I didn't think I had that kind of aspiration as much as I just wanted to have a career, study something that I have a long career in.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it.
Mm-hmm.
I never dreamed that, I mean, the wealth and the what have you that has been generated through these sales is far staggering. It's far past anything I ever thought of. And but we give away a lot of it. We give away so much, and to us it's important that we realize that we're just stewards of someone else's money, and that someone else is God's money. He gave it to us, and we give it away the way He wants it. So, and we have this foundation that is a heavily funded, and it gives away money all the time.
Mm-hmm. And I guess, how have you seen the Asian American community, or just Asian American representation, change throughout your life? Because you've been all over U.S.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I see the Asian, it's really funny. It's this running joke within our family that we drive around and we see an Asian family or couple, and I don't know, this typical, really geeky looking guy that's got a camera strapped around his neck. And I mean, it's just funny, and then it's a stereotypical kind of look of Asians that come here to visit from Japan or wherever. And I have found that over these more recent years that I've connected much better with Asian people, Chinese, Korean, Japanese, Vietnamese, many different Asian cultures through this Asian society. And I've really, really enjoyed that.
Mm-hmm.
I really have. It's something that I was not exposed to it all through high school, elementary school and high school. There was no Asians.
Mm-hmm.
Zero. I was the only one in a school of 2,200 kids.
Mm-hmm.
One Asian. And no, there was one other girl. There's a Patricia Fechner. I still know. But there was two of us. And, you know, it's really interesting. In college, University of Kansas at the time was lily white. It was
mm-hmm.
super white. And today, there's a lot of Asians there at KU.
Mm-hmm.
But I was not exposed
mm-hmm.
to Asians at all. And but now, with our work at the Asia Society, it's completely different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And how did you get to know about the Asia Society?
I guess it was about 4 or 5 years ago. They had a exhibit, and the gala was on Japan. And we thought, wow, we gotta check this out. And so we did, and met some people there, and it was a lot of fun, and we just stayed involved and helped, because Asian Society doesn't just, as you know, doesn't just cater to Japan or China.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like Indian and Pakistani and all the different Asian societies, and so it's really, really interesting to learn all that kind
mm-hmm.
Of the different cultures.
Yeah. And how do you see the future of Asian American community?
Well, I think the way I look at it is that the university levels in Japan are different than here in the United States. Here in the United States, you work hard your elementary and high school years, and then you get into a university and you really work hard in the university too. In Japan, you work hard, very hard, to get into a prestigious university, and once you get in, it's not as rigorous at all. And so, you know, that was that. There's a big difference between the two, and that I talked to a lot of Japanese American, and they say we like bringing our kids here to learn in the universities in the United States, but what happens is, at least from Japan, most of the time, the people graduate from the universities and go back to Japan or China or Vietnam or wherever they're from, and they go back, and that's kind of it's interesting because it's they don't really they don't stay here in the United States, and that's why there isn't this huge, like, you look at the Hispanic community, what is 50% right now, and they come and they come and they come and they stay. And that's why you don't see a, I mean, there's a Vietnamese community kind of in Sugarland area, a pretty big community, but not nearly as big as the Hispanic and so anyways, I see the it not being this huge wave of continued Asians coming in and then being just because it's harder, immigration laws are tougher. Now you're a U.S. citizen. Are you?
No, I'm an international.
International, yeah. So you, it's hard if you wanted to be a citizen. It's kind of you got to go through a lot to get a company to sponsor you, to put all that thing, get your green card, and then so that's those barriers keep the Asians kind of out. And don't allow a huge migration.
Is there anything you would like to advise to the future generations?
Yeah, I would like to say that congratulations on where you are right now. You two in particular have reached and are studying at arguably one of the finest institutions in the world, maybe. And in academia, there's a lot of liberalism. And just research everything that you hear and understand what it is that you're backing. Because a lot of times people back things, ideas, or movements because all their friends are backing it. And I can cite so many instances where people have been kind of led astray a bit just because it was the popular thing to do. And, you know, listen to your conscience, because your conscience really is something that is not getting bombarded by external stimuli. So that's what I would say probably to this generation.
This question just came up in my mind, but have you been back to Japan recently?
You know what? That's a great question, because I am going in March 11th. I'm leaving with my whole family, taking the whole family.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
How long has it been since you've been back?
I've never been.
Oh, really?
Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's going to be an interesting experience.
Yeah, it really is. I'm excited. I really am. It's. I talked to some of the people just this week from Japan, and they said, well, you'll be the tallest person there, that's for sure.
Do you have any goals in mind for this trip?
Well, it's just to really understand the culture more, immerse myself in the culture, and really pay attention to what people do, how they do it, and why.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I want to try to learn most from the mm-hmm. from the trip.
Mm-hmm. And where's your like family originally from in Japan?
Well, I don't know exactly for sure, but I do know on a ship manifest that I found that it left Okinawa,
mm-hmm.
which is the island off the I think the eastern side of the country. But they could have come from a long right. distance mm-hmm. to get there because that was the port that they left
from. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are you planning on visiting that?
No, it's actually in we're going to Tokyo to Hiroshima to see the atomic bomb mm-hmm. Memorial, Kyoto to see all the shrines and everything that, and as a matter of fact, that was all spared during the war. Mm-hmm. We're going out in the country and experiencing what a authentic Japanese hotel system. It's called Ryokan, and there are the places that have the rice paper sliding doors mm-hmm. and the mm-hmm. tatami yeah. mats and the futons, and you mm-hmm. sit on lower tables. So I'm looking forward to that
yeah.
too.
Seems exciting.
Yeah, yeah. It really is.
Anything else you would like to add?
You guys have hit about every base that there is. It's very thorough, and I appreciate you guys researching mm-hmm. me and hopefully the stuff that I sent helped you give you a little outline.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, anything else?
I think I'm pretty good.
Thank you. So
okay,
much.
Thank you.
Yeah.